Good morning. Good morning, everybody. It's a welcome to Leamington, a Baptist, or as that little lyric was saying, welcome to the kingdom. What a wonderful thing to be able to welcome you into the kingdom of God. And that's what we do. We welcome you into the presence of the Holy One, the Living One, the Eternal One. So it's still lovely to have you in the building. It's lovely for anybody who's able to join us online. But glory to his name. It's lovely to share eternity and that little moment of eternity that we share with each other this morning, that fellowship. One or two little announcements before we begin. My name's Simon, for those who don't know. There's various contact details up on the screen and in various bits of paper around. Peter, our minister's on holidays for a few weeks, so the numbers and the contact details there work, or you can get through and have a word with me after the service if there's anything you'd like to talk about. As I said, a couple of little practical things. This meeting, or this week, on Wednesday evening, the 27th, we have a church meeting. That's where the members come together and look to the Lord for his will for the direction of the church. That'll be 7:30 in the room next door on Wednesday evening. Because that's extra to our normal pattern, we're not having a meal at that. So please, if you arrive early for a meal at 6:30, you'd be very welcome in the building, but I'm afraid there won't be any food. You might get a cup of tea if you're lucky. However, next Sunday, which is the 1st of May, is a time when we enjoy the Lord's Supper together. And as well as having that meal as part of our service, we will also enjoy food after the service. So we'll have a lunch, a family lunch. It probably won't be the roast dinner that you might have at home, but it'll be a family lunch where we can enjoy not just, there's a sacramental, if you know that word, element to that Lord's Supper where we come together and we recognize the Lord, but there's also an element of it which is illustrative of how we enjoy each other's company. So we'll have that time afterwards to enjoy each other's company. Looking a little bit further ahead, those who have seen the newsletter for this week, you'll know that Gene Ingalls, well, we know that Gene passed away on the 5th of April. Gene's, the Thanksgiving service, the funeral and Thanksgiving for Gene will be on the 5th of May at 10:30. That's at Oakley Wood Crematorium. And the family have decided to have the main service of Thanksgiving at the Crem, and then they returned to the Angel Hotel, which is just around the road, for a reception afterwards. And they were very keen that I say that all of Gene's church family were welcome to that as well. So to give you that date for your diary. And then the last one, sorry, it's a long list of dates, I realize that. So that's church meeting in the middle of this week, meal next Sunday, Gene's Thanksgiving service on the 5th of May, and then on the 15th of May, we have a time to celebrate here. As you all know, Peter, who has been in ministry for 18 months, is now moving on to other things. So on the 15th of May, we'll come together to celebrate that, the work that he has done amongst us, he and his wife Inger and their son Nathan, the work that they've done amongst us and the delight that they have brought to us over this 18 months while they've been with us. So that's the 15th of May. So sorry to give you, I'm not quite sure, I feel like I should have a tannoy to announce some of these things sometimes, but that's where we start. Let's get back to the kingdom of God. Let's get back to things eternal. I say we come together for an hour of a little bit longer on Sunday mornings. We also meet on Sunday evenings for those who want to. 6:30, back here again, there's a smaller, more intimate, more open meeting. All are welcome. But we meet to enjoy the presence of the Lord Jesus. Also to know that the Lord Jesus is our King. That's why we talk about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. He is the one who has authority. He is the one who has authority in our meeting. Not me standing here, not Betty preaching, not the guys on the tech. He is the one who has all authority. As you know, if you've seen the newsletter, I've been thinking about the way that he comes to assist. So not only does he have the authority, He is also the source of all our strength and our energy. And I want to start the meeting just with that little word from Psalm 121. Things that will be familiar to you, I have no doubt. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. In the Old Testament, the hills are often where people had those wonderful meetings with God. So that's what the writer says. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. And as we come together this morning, that's what we want to remember, that the one who we worship, the one who we serve, does not slumber or sleep. The first song that we sing, we sang it last Sunday evening, in fact, and Chris introduced it as almost a song of the creed, a song which reminds us of those foundational truths that we have laid hold of. Not that it's just something we grab in our head, but the truths that have made a fundamental difference to who we are. We believe in Jesus. And Lord Jesus, we do know. It's more than simply believe. We know within the depths of our being that you are here. We know that because you reside within us. Glory to your wonderful name. You're here with grace to heal. You're here with grace to save. You're here with grace to empower. And Lord Jesus, what a wonderful thing to find ourselves in your kingdom. And Lord, with that, we want to speak out to you the truth that we enthrone you in our heart. We accept your lordship over our lives. Jesus, we enthrone you.
We worship in the dark.
Brothers and sisters, as you worship the Lord Jesus, I do encourage you to let him have his freedom in your heart. Let him stir you in the way that only he can. We are mortal men and women, creatures of dust, as the old hymn says. And yet, with the new life that has been poured within us, we are inhabitants of two places. Lord Jesus, you have us seated in the heavenlies. That's what Paul said in one of his letters. Lord, take us into that reality of knowing that we live in spiritual things with you. There must be more than this. Lord Jesus. Brothers and sisters, as that delight falls on you, as that spirit stirs your heart and revives the flame in you, take this time to pray out, to worship the God who you believe in, to tell him that he has the throne in your heart, to declare your love for him. Pray as you're led, brothers and sisters. Yeah. Glory.
Glory is your name.
Amen. 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 Father. Glory to your name, Lord. Lord, we do indeed worship you. And as Paul has said, we do cry out that glory needs to fall to your name. How could it be anything different, Lord, than your name be glorified? You are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the source of every life, and you are the perfection against which we will each be measured. How can we have been granted so great a salvation, Lord? Lord Jesus. We have an opportunity to sing again. There's a hymn which I often feel sounds much more recent. You sort of think it should have been Matt Redman or one of those guys. And yet, it's a lady called, I think it's Charity is her name, and it's from quite a long time ago, 100 years ago. For those who wish to sit, sit, that's fine. For those who wish to stand, that's also fine. We're going to sing Before the Throne of God Above. Please take a seat. Please take a seat. Our life is indeed hid with Christ on high. And it's because of that we have the wonderful privilege to intercede on behalf of others. And Rosie's going to come and lead us in our prayers.
Lord, as we come together in prayer, help us to remember that through you, all things will be made right and that all things are possible. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the changing seasons, for the blossoms and the bees and the leaves on the trees. May we be truly grateful for what we have around us every day. For those who are less able to enjoy, either physically or mentally, Lord, I ask that you will help us as individuals to help our neighbors enjoy these moments that you delight in. May we find peace and joy in the world around us and help others to find that peace and that joy too. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that Easter brings to reflect again on what you did for us on the cross. I pray again that we are humbled and made new by your blood. Thank you for the opportunity we've had to see friends and family, to rest and take time away from our busy lives. We think and pray for those who miss family, friends, the ability to rest for whatever reason. We ask in your name, Lord, that you be with them and that they may rest in you. As we delight in spring, the longer days, and warmer weather, our minds also turn to those places where it's already too hot for this time of year. The ongoing heatwave in India, Pakistan, and Central Asia. The North and South Poles, 20 degrees out of what is considered normal. Lord, I pray you will wake us up faster to what is going around, what is going on around us. Wake up our governments, our business leaders, our community leaders. Wake us up as a church, speak to us, and help us have the courage to face our reality. We pray especially for those who are and will be most affected by the changing climate, Lord. You told us the meek shall inherit the earth, that the last will be first. And we pray this again in your name. We pray for church leaders around the world of all faiths and denominations. May they hear your voice and guide their communities according to your word of love and forgiveness. We give thanks for their positions as leaders, and we pray your guidance over them as they speak out according to their beliefs and values. We pray especially for the ongoing row between our government and church leaders about the Rwanda asylum plan, and that your will be done in this situation, and that those that seek refuge here are welcomed. Lord, we pray for all of those who seek asylum, who need safety, who need clean water, food, love, and security. There are so many, Lord, who need this. May you be with them. We ask you give them hope. We ask you soften our hearts to their needs and encourage us to find ways that we can help, practically, financially, or emotionally. Lord, we turn our prayers to our community, to our church, to our town, to those we know and love. We pray your blessing, healing, and peace on Neville and Joe Bates. Thank you for all they do. Be with them in this time. We pray for the family of Jean Ingalls as they prepare to give thanks for her life and plan the funeral. We give thanks for Tom's improvements and ask you to continue to heal. For all those we know and love, and those we don't, Lord, but we know that you know them intimately, who need your comfort and healing, we ask now that you wrap your loving, healing arms around these people. Finally, we give thanks for the amazing work Peter and Inga have done in our church. We pray your blessing and guidance over them in the coming months. May they feel your presence, Lord, your love and your support. And we pray also for us as a church body in this time, for all of us as individuals and us as a community, as a church, as one. We think especially for the church meeting on Wednesday, and we pray that you will speak to us and that you will guide us and that you will continue to do great things through us as we here, Lord, are your hands and feet. We give thanks for all of your continued blessing, and we ask all of the above in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning's reading comes from St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, reading verses 13 to 35. That's Luke chapter 24, 13 to 35. An encounter with Jesus on the day of his resurrection. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they didn't see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he was going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem, and there they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told them what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Thanks be to God for his word.
Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the way? Can you hear me?
Yep.
All right. All right. Heartburn. That's the theme of my sermon. But first of all, let me talk about the last 2 years during lockdown, and we've had restrictions. And I don't think I've ever drunk so much in my life. Now, I don't think I've become an alcoholic, because I haven't, but I'm thinking of tea and coffee. Now, I have never loved tea, and I've been forced to have it quite a lot, especially as my lovely girls who look after me now, they can't master my cafetiere, so and I don't like anything but fresh coffee. So I'm having to learn to cope with tea. And I can remember a very dear friend of this church had me for a meal once, and I said, please don't give me tea, Lois. And it was Lois Godfrey, and she then said, but I'll try some fruit teas on you. So I said, well, all right then. So we did. But I bore them. I don't really like tea. But I bear it, and I'll drink it. But what I can't drink is cold tea or tepid tea. That's even worse. And sometimes my friends will make me a cup of tea and I'll forget all about it. And then I look at it and I taste it and I think, oh, absolutely awful. It may be good for plants, but and also for Welsh bread, I gather, but I certainly don't want this. Oh, no. Their hearts on that Emmaus road were warmed. They were better, they were burning. Some translations just say warmed. Wesley was famous for his expression that his heart was strangely warmed. And that was when he came to know the Lord. But I think it's better burning. His heart was strongly warm. Is your heart warmed? Is it? Are you a warm Christian? A warm fellowship? What about all of us? Well, let me go back to the story then. One of the two stories which I love in the Easter story, one set in the early morning when Mary met Jesus in the garden, and this one set at sunset. This story is difficult to think about, but when you think about it, this man suddenly appeared. But if you have ever driven on a summer evening, you know jolly well how difficult it is to see everything, and you're dazzled. Maybe they were dazzled and they didn't recognize him. Or if you're like me too, if you're on your own walking, and they were almost on their own because they were talking about one thing and they were totally engrossed in it. But if you're thinking about something that's bothering you or even something that's giving you joy, you're quite oblivious to the rest of the people passing by. And I have been pulled up many times for not speaking to people and not seeing them. But I passed you, but I touched you almost. No, it doesn't work. So there may have been several reasons. They were talking about it. They were so in despair. Mary had come and told the disciples all about Jesus appearing to her. The disciples said so, but no, not them. And so they had stayed all day in that locked room. And, you know, somehow it was a relief when the time came for them to come out. It was fresh air and they could talk as well as they liked. Walls have ears. But on a lonely country road going to a village, there was no one except this stranger, and one man wouldn't matter. And so they were totally engrossed in their conversation until Jesus butted in. And then began a very, very long sermon, because there were seven miles to go, and he hadn't finished when they arrived, because he was going to go further on, but they wanted to hear more. Now, most of us would be thoroughly bored with a sermon that long, but not them. They were absolutely held by it. And as he unfolded the scriptures to them, and it all began to mean something. That walk went probably quicker than any of the walks they'd done to Jerusalem and back in the whole of their lives. They didn't notice the time. And if we truly walk with him, we can't be bored. We're held by him. He's talking to us and he's sharing with us. And they were walking with Jesus. But when they got to Emmaus, of course, we hear that they said, let come in, don't go on. He was going further. And so they said, abide with us. And that reminds me of that verse in Revelation. If anyone opens the door to bid him welcome, he will come into him. You see, Jesus doesn't push his way into our lives. He waits for us to invite him. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for thee. Maybe we need to invite him. Maybe there's somebody here tonight today who hasn't yet invited Jesus into their heart. Or maybe for most of us, there's a time where we need to consider, do we need to invite him in again? Are we shutting him out? What are we doing? Well, we need to invite him again. They went into that simple meal, and of course, the next bit is the climax, because he breaks that bread, and they instantly know it is Jesus. They know straight away. Nobody's ever, they've seen him do it so many times. This is him. And then he disappears, and what do they do? You just thought, well, they would sit down and think about it, but no, they've walked 7 miles. It's dark by this time. They're tired, but they can't get back quick enough to Jerusalem to tell the others. And how life like that is, because we can be so anxious to tell somebody, we can't wait till we see them, to tell them. Oh, that we could be so equally excited about telling others that we've seen Jesus. I want to just divert for a time, moment, because when I read this story again, and this is the wonder of the Bible to me, that we see something that we've never seen before. We've read it, but we've never seen it. And one of the phrases that hit me as I read it again was that they were all discussing that Mary had seen him, they'd seen him, and the Lord appeared to Simon. And I never really thought about that very much. But what a thing that must have been. Simon was absolutely devastated. He had failed Jesus miserably. And he loved him. And he couldn't even go to the cross with John to see him crucified. That was just beyond him. And he kept apart from the others. And then this day came. And the thing that strikes me is that Jesus went out of his way to speak to Simon personally. And what a moment that must have been. Simon must have realized the great love that God has for us, and that all that he'd done was wiped out. He knew that instinctively, and he must have been full of joy. And what a moment that must have been for him. But that stresses how God so loves us that he will seek us out, yes, but he waits for us to come to him. Now we need to share with others. We need to share what we have seen and experienced. And that is something we don't often do. We're often too shy and reserved. We need to encourage each other more than ever. I believe that is the main role as a family, that we need to console each other. But so often we don't. We concentrate on being comfortable with each other. We don't bother about people's troubles. They're with us, that's it. And we enjoy it. And we never think of anybody outside at all. And to me, that is something where we fail as friends. I can imagine that fellowship that night was very warm. It was warmer than it had ever been. They had welcomed Jesus, and in the midst of it, he says to them, "Peace be with you." But they had to be more than warm. Just as Wesley, having been warmed, became a hot gospeler all over the country, Wales, Ireland, and all over England too. There are many, many places where I've been where it says Wesley stood here. And he did everything. He was a hot gospeler. Paul said in Romans 12, not to lack zeal or let it flag. Zeal is an interesting word. We don't use it very often now. And I think we often debase it. So when I looked it up in the dictionary, it said, having fervour and earnestness. But it comes from the Greek, which means, wait for it, to boil, to be hot. But it has to be true zeal, doesn't it? It has to be centred on our Lord. People can be very zealous for all sorts of things, and it's hard to have a burning desire to do things, but if they're not in God's will, then they're useless. To be burning to love him and to seek to show that love to others, and furthermore to show what God's love can be for them. Now, Count Zinzendorf was the leader of the Moravian Church in the time of Wesley, and he was friends with Wesley. They were great friends. And he said, "I have only one passion, and that is he. Passion, zeal." Paul wanted above anything for those who became Christian to have minds aflame with the truth of God, hearts burning with love for God and men, and a will ablaze with this passion. But zeal can flag, as Paul well knew, and we flag too. We have times when we've been on the mountaintops, but suddenly everything has gone dead. And maybe we're feeling a little like that at the moment because of the change in our circumstances. We are maybe flagging. We are maybe beginning to doubt. We maybe can't sing with the same earnestness as we did. We've come like cold tea. Paul tells Timothy, kindle again the flame which has died down on the altar of your life. Tepid Christians can help no one. John knew that. If you look at Revelation in the book of the Church of Laodicea, they were condemned utterly for being lukewarm. I think it is how one Christian puts it, we must be kept at boiling point by the Spirit. We must be kept at boiling point by the Spirit. And so often we shut the Spirit out of our lives. It really serves us. Jesus told them that they would receive the Spirit, and that is what needs to be. For those early disciples, it was necessary. For us, it's necessary if we're going to burn with love for him and love for each other. We know that we often have points when we are really up in the clouds, but also we can so easily sink down. It's difficult to stay there, and we cannot generate enthusiasm and generate fervour by ourselves. It's only by the fire of the Spirit. You see, nothing significant happened after that after Easter for a long time. What happened to the disciples? Nothing particularly happened, did it? Easter Day brings the joy of the risen Lord. But it wasn't until Pentecost that the climax really came. The power of the Holy Spirit, which Jesus promised before he was crucified. So nothing really significant was going to happen to them till that day of Pentecost. To receive that power and that comfort, there seems to be a filling, an absolute filling of the Spirit in our lives. We need to wait on the Lord. And that word wait comes a lot in our Bibles. We need to wait, we need to pray, we need to read his word, we need to make time to just think about him and sit with him. And however busy we are, it counts nothing unless we spend that time with him. We can be busy at church work, but it will not help us to grow, and it will not help us to share with others. We need to read his word every day. We need to encourage one another. Those early followers were really hot for God. Are we hot? I ask you that question again. Are we hot? Am I hot? I have my times when I'm certainly far from that. But were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the way? And we're going to sing a hymn of Wesley's now, which the musicians were a bit nervous about, but I hope we shall do it all right. O Thou Who Comest From Above. And in it, it really talks about this fire to me. O Thou Who Camest From Above, the pure celestial fire to impart, kindle a flame of sacred love on the mean altar of my heart. There let it for thy glory burn with inextinguishable fire, blaze, and trembling to its source return in humble love and fervent praise. Let's sing that hymn now.
In all our flaming
Betty reminded us, in, as she concluded, of Paul's instruction to Timothy to stir up that which was within him. Lord Jesus, we know that we have no source of flame within ourselves other than that which you ignite. And that which you fuel, and that which you continue to sustain. Lord, we're so wonderfully grateful that you choose to put us in a community of people where we have the opportunity to stir each other up, to press each other on towards that prize. And yet, here we are this morning, each one of us, before your throne, as we said earlier on, or as we sang earlier on. And we humbly ask, Lord, that you come and that you work with each one of us, wherever we are, that the life that you have put within us would be stirred up and energized to its full vigor. Lord, we pray that for each other. We pray that for the fellowship as a whole. And now we take a moment to bless each other as we draw our reading to a close. Say the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen. Amen.